some things we kind of taken for granted as we studied this. But tonight we're going to find out some more information about dating and different things like that. Bob had shared with us last night a little bit about what was going to be talked about tonight, and I'm excited to listen to him tonight. I'm looking forward to it. For those of you who are visiting with us, we welcome you for the first time. Anyway, we'll welcome you tonight, and I think that you'll enjoy the program. I am Pastor Ken Olin, and I'm very glad to see you here tonight. For those of you who are visiting with us for the first time, I'll share with you a little bit about our facilities here. If you'd like to, our restrooms are through these double set of doors here and down the hallway, and they're at your convenience down there, just not too far. If you need something to drink, we do have some drink out here in the foyer, and we'll have some little refreshments after our meeting tonight, so please stick around for that. See, I could have shared a little bit about Bob, his background again. Our presenter, Bob Krupa, has an engineering background, so he's into those kinds of things, and I appreciate that because that was my background as well. But just read a little bit about Bob here as an introduction to our speaker. He had worked with as a project design engineer, and specifically in the fluid power engineering, so hydraulics and that sort of thing. He worked also as an instructor into this field in the fluid power industry, and this position allowed him to allows him to take the time as now to come to us. He's traveled to us from Minneapolis and share with us, so it gives him time to do that. And also he was raised as a Lutheran and went through the public school system. And of course there you get a lot of this information about evolution, not so much about creation, do you, when you go to public school, but a lot about evolution. And so he had a lot of questions about that. After hearing the SDA message in 1989, and taking a step out in faith to believe the Bible, regardless of man's opinions, the door started opening for him and enabling him to use his engineering background to study the assumptions and evidence about evolution. And we could tell from last night that he has did a lot of research on this. And so it's been his desire and his calling to share his 15 plus years of study on this topic with other people like us here tonight. So we really appreciate, Bob, you being with us and sharing your knowledge of this topic. You know, there are a lot of different things, stories about this and different research that goes on with this particular topic, and it's really helpful to be able to have someone who's actually telling the truth about these things, and we can count on that. Well, I think that before we get started, I want to thank you all for filling out your registration cards and signing up for our meeting. We do have a wonderful drawing each night that we meet together, and so I'd like to share that part of it tonight. Let me set this down here for a moment. We have some wonderful materials out on the table, and we're going to allow you to choose once you if you win. Which materials that you'd like. We have wonderful books out there. For instance, Origin by Design is written by Kaufman, Brown, and Gibson. It's a wonderful book about the origin by design, the creation story. We have some videos as well, DVDs. The Privileged Planet is one of these sort resources that we have, and we have some other ones back there that are for your choosing. And also we have something that you might think it's for the kids, but us adults like books that have the comics in it. So sometimes that's really nice for even us adults to read. But we have a wonderful book here, a number of books, A Creation's View of Dinosaurs. So if that's something that you're interested in, that's a great book to be able to pick up to on the table. One item that we're giving away each night, if you've come in tonight for the first time, you should have received or will receive a little booklet by Joe Cruz is his name, How Evolution Flunked the Science Test. So you can kind of tell where we're headed with this tonight in terms of creation and evolution. But it's good to challenge our thinking. Also, we have a question and answer when Bob comes up, and if you don't mind, I'll just kind of share the 3x5 cards. You should be able to get one of those tonight as well. If you have any questions about what Bob has talked about tonight, please write down some questions, and I'm sure that you will have some questions. Write them down on the 3x5 card, and we'll have a time where Bob will be answering these questions, and I'm sure when he comes up, that's what he'll be doing tonight. So feel free, you don't have to put your name on it. You can just write out your, and I guess I'll go ahead and pass those out now so that you have them with you during the session. And write down your questions, and just go ahead and turn them in at the end. You can either hand them to him or hand them to me or one of your row hosts, your questions, and then they'll go ahead and make sure that Bob gets those. Okay, am I missing anything, Bob? I don't think I'm missing anything. Well, it's time for our drawing. I think do we have all the tickets available? Trying to get a volunteer to come up? Yeah. All right, well, Jeanette will do it for us tonight. And Jeanette wants to stay here because we'll put it nice up high so you can really reach it. We'll pick a ticket out of here. She can't see what she's picking there. What's the number on the ticket?
808-021.
021. Who has a 021 on their ticket? You should have your tickets, right? 021. It's you, okay, James.
Thank you.
All right. Well, James, you can pick your resource. When I'll go out on the table, I'll put those back out there. Okay. Well, let's have a word of prayer, and then I'll invite Bob to come up and share with us tonight. Father in heaven, we thank you for this wonderful evening that we can spend together. We thank you, Lord, for sending Bob to us to share with us the things that he studied, and that we can open up our minds, perhaps, to a new way of looking at this particular topic, and freshen our minds to some extent as to the backgrounds and experiences that we've had as we relate to this topic. Please guide and direct in our time together. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Bob, for sharing with us.
Good evening. Good evening. How is everybody tonight? It's perfect night for studying a little bit about the world, isn't it? It's time to be around and see everything we need to see. But before we begin, I want to just cover a little bit about what was going on and what we covered last night. And remember what the purpose of the seminar is. The purpose of the seminar was just to provide you with information. It's always going to be your choice to make the decision of what you're going to believe. We're not trying to tell anybody what to believe. We just feel that you should have all the evidence available when you make that decision. And it's an important decision to make. So we only provide evidence that's been proven and that's agreed with by any scientist that's out there. We're not going to use hypothetical situations. We're not going to make assumptions. All the quotes that you're going to see in the seminar are all from well-respected scientists, and most of those quotes are from evolutionary scientists. So we're not looking at anything that's going to be really off the wall or anything like that. Everything, like I said, is going to be all proven evidence that we can see and round, and is not going to be in dispute. And last night, if you were here last night, you remember that we talked a little bit about 6 days of the Big Bang, and that was the title of our seminar last night, and we found out that the Big Bang Theory has some problems. Not the TV show, that one's doing good. But the Big Bang Theory itself has some problems. Some of those problems were we have no explanation where matter came from. You know, remember we talked a little bit about energy and matter and how it creates antimatter as well as matter. So we had problems with where the matter came from in the beginning, how the Big Bang actually developed. We have problems with how galaxies are formed. There's no explanation for galaxies being formed. There was no explanations for a star being formed. We had problems with our solar system itself, the age of our sun versus the Earth and the temperatures of the Earth. We've seen a lot of things that had to do with the universe around us, and we've seen a lot of problems, and we found out that the only explanation, even from an evolutionary scientist standpoint, was that there was a suspension of all laws. In other words, there was a complete miracle to create the universe. And we've seen that a little bit last night. Now, tonight we're going to be talking about the age of the Earth. But before we begin, typically what I like to do is share a little bit about who I am, what my journey was, and how I got to the point where I'm at today. But we do have a lot of questions that we're going to answer, so I'm only going to give you a little tidbit. When I was growing up, I grew up as a Lutheran, as Pastor Ken was saying. And as a Lutheran, I went to school and I went to church. But when I went to school, I was taught about evolution. I was taught about how the dinosaurs lived millions and millions of years ago, how the universe is billions of years old. And I had a lot of questions as I was growing up. And as a young person, my mind is kind of analytical. That's probably the reason why I got into an engineering field. That's probably the reason why I like to deal with things that are more factual and not just hypotheticals. I like to have things kind of laid out in front of me. And I started having a serious problem between Christianity, between religion, and between evolution. And it got to the point, by the time I was in about 6th, 7th grade, I had a serious doubts on religion. And I became an atheist as I grew up, and I went through high school and into college. And that kind of started me out in following the evolution theory, because like I said, I was very analytical based minded. I like to look on logic, and what I was being taught in school is this is what happened here, this is what happened here. It seemed very well laid out. Everything seemed into a logical format, and I never looked at any of the assumptions behind it. And I didn't get the answers that I was looking for from a religious standpoint. So by the time I was going through high school, and by the time I was graduating from high school, I was seriously an atheist. I doubted God's existence at all on the earth. That was the first part. But we'll get to the second part tomorrow night, so now I got a reason for you to come back, right? But we're going to look at the age of the earth itself tonight. We're going to study a lot of the scientific claims on the age of the earth, and we're going to look at, like we talked about last night, some of the limiting factors. Remember the ship? If we find a sunken treasure ship, we pull up the little treasure box and we start looking at the coins. If we know one coin was from 1690, another one was from 1750, we know the ship couldn't have sunk before 1750. So we look at limiting factors, and that's how it helps us determine a maximum age limit for different things that we see. But before we get into that, we need to deal with some questions and answers, and we're going to ask Brianna if she can come down, and we have a lot of questions that we're going to cover tonight. So just a reminder, you have the index cards. If any questions come up, if they have to do with creation, they have to do with evolution, or they have to do with anything else, feel free to write it down, and we'll try to get to them all tomorrow night as well. So what's our questions?
All right. Our first question is, so where do creationists say a comet comes from?
That's a good question. So we talked about comets last night a little bit. When we talked about comets last night, we learned that comets have a specific lifespan because every time they pass by the sun, they lose some of their mass. And they continue to pass by the sun. Short period comets pass by the sun every 200 years or less. Long period comets are 200 years or longer. And we found out that if we had a 4.6 billion year old solar system and 4.6 billion year old Earth, that we shouldn't have comets traveling around because they don't last much longer. They can't last that long to be able to be considered around today. So where do the creationists say the comets came from? The creationists actually look at the comets and they say, the comets actually have been here from the beginning. We don't have a solar system that's that old that the comets could have burned out yet. So where did they actually come from? There's a lot of explanations and where they came from originally. Basically, it comes to massing up of particulates and ice and water and gas and dust and everything else that builds up a comet to begin with. But they would have came here and they would have been created in their form. What's our next question?
All right, our next question is the speed of, is it true that the speed of light is not constant?
It is true that the speed of light is not constant. And we talked a little bit about that last night. We had a few different universities and some professors that have ran some tests, and they've been able to slow down the speed of light. They've even been able to stop the speed of light. And if you take a look and you look online, you'll find out that the speed of light isn't there anymore when you start looking for it. If you type in, the speed of light, constant, and everything else, you'll find that the definition of that number that we've always assigned to the speed of light is now the definition. In fact, one of the people that were here last night actually looked it up the other night, and they let me know that the definition for that now, if you look it up, is that it's a piece of basically a piece of particulate, a material in a vacuum, in a perfect vacuum, the maximum speed of a material in a perfect vacuum. So what they've done is they've taken the speed of light and they said, okay, this is the number that's associated with the speed of light, but we don't call it the speed of light anymore. We say this is the maximum speed of a particulate in a perfect vacuum, because the speed of light has changed and the speed of light has not been constant. A little complex, but the speed of light is not a constant. What's our next question?
All right, is the moon rotating?
Is the moon rotating? Yes, the moon actually is rotating. Is there more to that question?
There is. Is there a dark side of the moon?
There is. There's a dark side of the moon, and you say, okay, how's the moon rotating? And that there's still a dark side of the moon that we don't see. Because remember, we have the dark side of the moon. There's one side of the moon that we see and another side that we don't. But if we take a look at the moon as it's traveling around, when it's rotating, when it's orbiting the Earth, it's actually rotating while it orbits. And that rotation while it orbits is actually matching the face of the Earth. So that's why we have a dark side of the moon. But the moon itself is rotating as it orbits the Earth. So if you looked at the moon itself, it's actually rotating. It just happens to be rotating at the same orbit that it goes around the Earth. So we always have one side of the moon that's away from the Earth. But even when the moon's on this side of the Earth, when it's on the other side, it's still rotating. So not only is the moon rotating, it's also orbiting the Earth, and it's orbiting the sun.
Okay, I think you answered the third part of that question. It was, if yes, then why can't we see the other side of the moon?
There we go.
So how was the Grand Canyon formed?
That's a really good question. How was the Grand Canyon formed? And I'm going to tell you, you got to wait. The reason why is we're going to talk about that tonight. And sometimes the questions that we're going to receive are going to be questions that we're going to be covering yet tonight or tomorrow night. So if I get one of those, I'm going to say, just hold on a little bit. We'll talk about this in much more detail, and we'll talk about that one tonight.
Okay. What is the latest dates you used in your presentation? What is the distribution of date quotes?
If we're talking about dates in the presentation, I have quotations from different scientists that can span more than 50, 60 years. A lot of them, some of these quotes actually go back to the 1970s, and some of them are very recent. As far as the other question, the range of the date quotes, some of the information that we have in here is from 2016, 2017, even more recent. But we do have quotes that go back from the 1970s as well. And the reason why is not that the date itself is old information and now outdated. Remember when we talked about it, the only information that we're going to use is scientifically factual information. It means it's not going to change. It was agreed as being truth back in the 1970s, and it's still agreed as being truth today.
Okay. Wasn't the Earth without form and void older than 6,000 years?
That's a very good question. So the Earth without form or void older than 6,000 years. And as we study the age of the Earth tonight, I think we end up getting an answer to that question, because there's a lot of things that are involved with the age of the Earth itself. Now, in Genesis 1:1, it talks about the earth was without form and was void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. So when we look at it, we can say, well, how long did it exist without form and being void, sitting there in space? Well, without form, it says it has no form. And void, it means it's empty. There's nothing there. So what was the shape of the earth? What was the material? Was the material there or not? These are a lot of philosophical questions. But what we can do is we can take a look at the Earth as it is today, and we can see the material that's made up of the Earth, and we can determine some dates from that. So tonight, when we look at the age of the Earth, we will be able to answer a lot of those questions.
Okay, don't galaxies exhibit the Fibonacci pattern?
There we go, the Fibonacci pattern. Mm-hmm. And that's a really interesting pattern. The Fibonacci formula is what it really comes to. If you look at it, here's how it works, is we take a number like 1, then we take another number, 1. And if we take those two numbers and add them together, 1 plus 1 is 2. So the next number would be 2. Now we take 2 plus the previous number, 1. We add them together, we get 3. We get 3 plus the previous number, 2. We add them together, we get 5. And so it goes 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13. And it continues on from there. The Fibonacci pattern actually exists in more than just galaxies. It exists in quite a different places. Now some galaxies are spiral galaxies, and they exhibit some of the Fibonacci patterns in their spirals. There we go, we're back. So with the pattern, we'll see that in some of the spiral galaxies, but we do have galaxies that are not spiral galaxies as well, and they don't exhibit that pattern. One thing, it's a little side topic, but it's very interesting, that pattern, we also see that in hurricanes. We see the spiraling of the hurricanes. We see that in pine cones. If you take a look at a pine cone, and you look at where the pine cone connects to the tree, and you can look at the pine cone, you'll see that pattern in most of the pine cones. Some pine cones don't exhibit it, others do. But you see that number pattern even in our human hand. If we take a look at our hand, we've got a certain number of bones, and they're separated by joints. And if we take the measurements of the first bone, it'd be like a 1, the second bone would be like a 2, and 1 plus 2 is 3, and the third bone is a 3, and the next one was 5 for as far as distance. So we see that type of pattern in a lot of things around us, not just in galaxies.
Okay. Is there actually a center of the universe?
Is there actually a center of the universe? And before I answer that, I want to say one thing. That pattern is called the golden ratio. And it's found in a lot of different things. But is there a center to the universe? Last night we found out with a red shift of starlight that all the galaxies around our home galaxy are in 1 million year quanta shifts. So basically we got a 1 million year shell of the galaxies around our galaxy, another empty space, and then another 1 million light year shell of galaxies around our galaxy again, and it continues going on and on. The only possible way that can happen from a mathematical statement is that if our home galaxy is near the center of the universe. So the universe actually does have a center, and it's been proven through the Hubble law and the telescopes and looking at the redshift of starlight to show that we are actually near the center of the universe.
Okay, what is meant by empirical evidence?
Empirical evidence. We talked about that a little bit with science. We have the scientific method, and science is all about observable, empirical, measurable evidence. Empirical, what they mean by empirical means that this is data that is consistent and repeatable. So we have the observation, we can look and we can see something, and if we see something one time, that's an observation. But if we see something and we start an experiment, and we repeat the experiment over and over again, and we start collecting the data. We have empirical data when we collect the data again and again and again, so we eliminate the possibility of errors. So we're seeing it again and again and again. We continue to collect that data, and now we have a list of all the data that matches up to the previous experiments. When everything's run the same way, we eliminate any errors, and that's called empirical evidence.
Okay, last question. Is there a way to acquire your notes?
There could be, if you can read my mind. I do have a little bit of notes that I kind of keep on the screen here because it reminds me of certain numbers as I get older and older. We all have a little more trouble with numbers, so I keep some notes on the screen. But really, they're just little guidelines to keep me on topic. Otherwise, we'll go off on tangents and we'll be here till about 10 o'clock tonight. So a lot of the notes that I do have are just little guidelines or little notes that are saying, hey, here's what's coming up next. You got to talk about this next. So it matches up to the slides. But the notes themselves, like I probably mentioned the other night, it's something that I started when I was looking at living a life as an atheist, more or less, and I came back into a religious community. I had a lot of struggles with creation and evolution and the Bible. And as I went through and I studied a lot of these samples and a lot of these issues and a lot of these, I started learning a lot of different assumptions, and it was just years worth of gathering data for myself. So a lot of it's stuff that I know in my mind. I have some of it written down. The best thing I could tell you is get a copy of the videos. The videos are being made, so the church will have them. Get a copy of the videos. You can go through them over and over again, and then you got my mind in your home.
That's all we have.
All right, thank you very much. So tonight we're going to talk about the age of the earth, and before we begin into the age of the earth, we're going to talk about the three theories regarding the age of the earth. And remember, we talked about three theories last night. There's three main theories that we're going to see as we go through this. The first theory is the evolution theory, and regarding the age of the earth, the evolution theory says that the earth formed about 4.6 billion years ago, chemical life evolved on earth about 3.6 billion years ago, and mankind came around 4 million years ago. That's the evolution theory. Then we have what's called the theistic evolution theory. That's one of the main theories that are out there. They're saying Genesis 6 days are not 6 literal days. They're saying those 6 days were millions and millions of years. In other words, they call it either the day-age theory, where one day is an age of maybe 1 million years or maybe 1 billion years. And they also have something called the gap theory, which says that, okay, we had day one, day two, day three, but then there was a gap of a couple million years or 1 billion years before we got to day four. So basically what it's trying to do is trying to marry the Bible and evolution and not compromise on anything, but it compromises on the Bible side. And then we've got the creation theory. And the creation theory says that 6,000 years ago, the earth was made and God created it in 6 literal days. And these are very opposite, polar opposite theories, aren't there? And you can see that the theistic evolution theory, the theory that God used evolution to create what we see today, really follows the evolution theory, not the creation theory. So we got to kind of look at these things. Now remember, all of these theories are beliefs. Like we talked about last night, these are beliefs. We were not there to see it. None of it has been proven true. Nobody has recreated the earth that I'm aware of, and nobody's recreated the universe either. So what happens is, since we're not there in the beginning to witness the event, these all have to be based upon a belief or a faith. So these are much of a religious theories as they are scientific theories. Each one of them are valid as a scientific theory, and each one of them are valid as a religious theory. So what we need to do is look at all the evidence that's available before we make our own decision on whether it's creation or evolution. So let's take a look at the evolution model and what the evolution model says about the origin and the creation of the Earth. It says about 15 billion years ago, the universe exploded into existence through the Big Bang. About 4.6 billion years ago, the Earth evolved. The Earth was formed. It kind of coalesced and created the Earth and the solar system, the planets, the sun. And about 3.6 years ago, life evolved on this Earth. And humans evolved from ape-like creatures. In other words, it takes a lot of time, a lot of chance, and a lot of natural processes to get to where we are today. That's the evolution model. Now, some of the strongest arguments on the evolution model as far as the formation of the Earth are what's called the geologic column. And if you look at the geologic column, they use this as evidence that Earth is billions of years old. They say that it took millions of years for each of these layers to form. So if we dig down into the Earth, we find all these layers. We dig down, we'll find the Cretaceous layer, and then the Jurassic layer, and so on and so on as we go down Cambrian layer. All these different layers that we'll see in the Earth. Sometimes we look at the Grand Canyon, and we look at the sides of cliffs, and we see the strata that's in there, and we say, okay, we see all these different layers. Now, they say each layer took millions of years to form. It took a lot of time to put all the dirt on there and for the animals and the fossils to be encased in these layers. But the one thing is we have no complete column that exists anywhere in the world. This column as a complete whole doesn't exist. What we do find is we do find this column, and we do find some of the layers, but we find missing layers. Layers that don't even exist in one column that exist in another column. So we'll see like something between the Cretaceous layer and the layer above it in one column, but we don't find that layer above the Cretaceous layer in the next column. It's a completely different layer, and sometimes these layers are even upside down when we find them. They find one layer in one spot where it should be below the other layer and it's above it. So we do have a little bit of a problem. But we do have one thing that's very specific and very interesting in the geologic column, and that's called the KT boundary. The KT boundary exists between the Jurassic and the Cretaceous layer. It's the layer of mass extinctions. It's the one layer that we find that's consistent throughout the Earth, the Cretaceous layer. And the Cretaceous layer always has the same base layer that it's sitting on top of. Now, the Cretaceous layer is actually a chalk layer. It's a marine layer. The layer itself was created from the shells of marine animals, marine organisms. And it's the one layer that we see all these extinctions. All the fossils that we find are right there in the KT boundary. The majority of them are right there. It's just like a giant graveyard in the Earth. But it's the one layer we see everywhere. If we go over to England, you look at the White Cliffs of Dover, that's the chalk layer. That's the Cretaceous layer that's sitting there. It's the one layer that we see everywhere, and it's a marine layer. It's full of marine organisms. It actually gives evidence towards a worldwide flood. Now, they talk about these missing layers, and we have to answer the question, well, why are layers missing? If we have a completely missing layer, and one of the answers that's presented is erosion. Erosion can erode away layers, and that's very, very true. Erosion can erode away layers, and it erodes away the Earth and everything we see around us. If we have a river that runs by our house, we're going to see erosion all the time. If we live by a lake, we see the erosion of the lakeshore and everything else like that. Now, at the current rate of erosion, if we look at the rate of erosion of the continents throughout the entire world, that current rate of erosion, the world would have eroded, all the continents on this world should have eroded to flat within 10 million years. That's how strong erosion is. That's at the minimum erosion rate we find throughout the world. We would have 10 million years worth of continents, and then everything would be eroded flat and into the oceans by then. At the maximum erosion rate, that's about 1 million years. So if we have an Earth that's 4.6 billion years old and it hasn't eroded itself flat yet, it's an interesting thing. But we have something interesting with that geologic column. See, we have fossils that are in the geologic column, and if you looked at that geologic column, you'll see that there's different dates for different layers. The Jurassic layer was about 140 million years to 210 million years old. That's the date that they have assigned for the Jurassic layer. Now, where does that date come from? If we take a look in the earth sciences textbooks that we see in the public school system, we find out a couple things and say, how do we determine how old a fossil is? And it says the age of the rock of the layer determines the age of the fossil that's found in the layer. So what they're saying is, we know the age of the rock. We can say, okay, if I find these fossils in this rock, this layer of rock, the Jurassic layer, the Cretaceous layer, then these fossils are anywhere from 140 to 210 million years old. But if we go a few pages further in that same textbook, it says the age of the fossils determine the age of the rock. So it just told us that the age of the rock tells us how old the fossil is. And now it says that how old the fossil is, the age of the fossil tells us how old the rock is. That's called circular reasoning. So in other words, if I have a fossil, I know it's 150 million years old because I found it in this rock layer. And how do I know the rock layer is 150 million years old? Because I got a 150 million year old fossil in it. That's exactly what they're saying. It's called circular reasoning. So what do the scientists have to say about it? Here's some of the quotes. Are the authorities maintaining on the one hand that evolution is documented by geology? In other words, the fossils are dated by the rocks. And on the other, that geology is documented by evolution, that the rocks are dated by the fossils. Isn't this a circular argument? Here's another example. The rocks do date the fossils, but the fossils date the rocks more accurately. That's a very interesting statement to have, isn't it? Niles Eldred is one of the noted evolutionists of our day, and Niles Eldred had this to say about it. He said, paleontologists cannot operate this way. There's no way simply to look at a fossil and say how old it is unless you know the age of the rock it comes from. So Niles Eldred, he's saying, we can't tell the age of the fossil unless we know the age of the rock it's in. Continues on, and this poses something of a problem. If we date the rocks by their fossils, how can we then turn around and talk about patterns of evolutionary change through the time in the fossil record? He's saying this is circular reasoning. What's the response to this? This is an interesting response. The American Journal of Science has this to say. The geologist has never bothered to think of a good reply, feeling the explanations are not worth the trouble as long as the work brings results. But it continues on. The charge of circular reasoning and stratigraphing can be handled in several ways. It can be ignored as not the proper concern of the public. It can be denied by calling down the law of evolution. It can be admitted as common practice, or it can be avoided by pragmatic reasoning. The American Journal of Science is saying you have no right to question us on this topic. It can be ignored. It's not the proper concern of the public to have that concern about circular reasoning. That's what they're actually telling us. Scientists date the fossils by the rock, and they date the rocks by the fossils. Now, if we go into this a little deeper, even though we got this problem with circular reasoning, we'll go into it a little deeper and we'll say, okay, well, how do you date the fossil? How do you date the rock by the fossil? They use something that's called an index fossil. And an index fossil is something that they find in a certain rock layer, and they don't find it in other rock layers. So they find an index fossil, they'll find a fossil of, say, a fish. And they find this fish in a certain rock layer, like a 140 million year old rock layer. But that's the only layer they ever seem to find it in, is that particular rock layer. And they say, now that's an index fossil for that rock layer. So anything else that they find in that rock layer that they find the index fossil is that same age. It's called an index fossil. But there's a few problems with index fossils. In this quote, most of the species of maidenhair are extinct. Indeed, they served as index fossils for the strata until one was found alive. The youngest fossil, coelacanth, is about 60 million years old. Since one was rediscovered off of Madagascar, they're no longer claimed as index fossils, fossils which tell you that the other fossils in that layer are the same old, ripe age. So here's a coelacanth fish right there, an index fossil for a rock layer, and yet we're swimming with them today off of Madagascar. So it's been removed as a rock, as an index fossil for the rock layer. So these index fossils really have some problems themselves. In fact, over 90% of all the fossils found in the world are not index fossils because they're found in multiple layers. Or they're found alive later on. They're found in too many different layers of the rock to be considered index fossils. So the number of fossils used as index fossils continues to shrink each and every day. Every day we find another fossil in another rock layer, we find it in a rock layer where it shouldn't belong. We find index fossils that were supposed to be for one layer of rocks and index fossils for another layer of rocks, and then all of a sudden they find them both together in the same layer. And that eliminates both those rock layer fossils as index fossils. So that's the problem that we have. So we don't really use index fossils necessarily to date the rocks. So why are they saying that the index fossils, or that the fossils date the rock more accurately? Why not just use radioisotope dating of the rock itself? Have you ever heard of radioisotope dating or radiometric dating of the rock? Radioisotope rating is used to date igneous rocks. It is used to date the granites and the basalts, you know, lava rocks, stuff like that. Now, it cannot date sedimentary rocks. The shales, the limestones, the sandstones, those are the things that are formed, they're compressed, and they become rock over time. It's basically mud turning into rock. They can't date those, but they can date the other rocks, the granites and the basalts. So at least we can get some rock layers taken care of, right? But even then, we have some problems with radioisotope dating. So if we look into radioisotope dating a little bit further, the way it works is we look at a estimate the age of a rock based upon the radioactive layer particles that are in the rock. So if we have material, let's say like we have on the screen here, uranium-238. If we have uranium-238, it's a radioactive material, and that there's certain kind of atoms that are in nature that are unstable, and they change, they decay over a certain period of time. And they eventually they decay from one form to another. And if we look at the decay cycle of uranium-238, we find out uranium-238 goes through a process of decay until it reaches to the point where it becomes lead-206. And lead-206 is a stable element, so it doesn't decay any further. So uranium-238 would be called the parent element, and lead-206 would be called the daughter element. So all we need to do is we need to look at a rock and we say how much uranium-238 is in it and how much lead-206 is in it. And we know that the uranium that's in there decayed to the lead. So here's exactly how it works. It starts out when the rock cools. When the rock cools, it's in a molten state. And the assumption is made that the intent heat forces any of the daughter elements to escape from the rock. So if we're looking at uranium-238, that says that when that rock is in its molten state, when it was first forming, when the Earth first formed, that rock would have been in a molten state, and any lead-206 that would have been there would have been melted out of the rock. It would have been forced out of the rock. Now, once that rock cools, it's assumed that there's no more daughter element that's left in that rock. So you'll still have uranium-238, but you'll have no lead-206 in there. So now all we need to do is measure the ratio of uranium-238 to lead. And if we know how long it takes uranium-238 to turn into lead, we can determine by that ratio the difference between them two how old the rock is. Makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? It's using something called a half-life. Now, a decay rate is measured in terms of a half-life. A half-life is the length of time it takes the remaining atoms of a particle to turn into another. So if you look at it this way, if we look at the top of the page here, it says polonium, and polonium will turn into lead, and it turns to lead in about 3 minutes. So let's say I had a jar of polonium in my hand right now. We don't want to hold that because that'll cause problems holding the jar of polonium. But if I had a jar filled with polonium, in 3 minutes, half of that jar would be lead. That's called a half-life. Half of the polonium turns to lead. Now I have a half a jar of polonium. In three more minutes, a half of that that's remaining will turn into lead. Now I have three-quarters of a jar of polonium. So it goes by halves, by halves. Every 3 minutes, it goes half, 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 half. And if I look at it and I say, okay, I have one-quarter of a jar of polonium and three-quarters of a jar of lead, that means there were two half-lives. A half-life 3 minutes, it was 6 minutes that that jar was sitting there, it's full of polonium. That's what half-life is, and that's what radiometric dating is. So half-lives are measured today are very accurate. Even half-lives like the uranium-238 that's down here, which is a 4.47 billion year half-life to it, it can be measured statistically in the lab pretty quickly. Now there are some issues with that. One of those is that the half-life actually matches up, and the calculation for a half-life is based upon the speed of light. We talked about the speed of light changing, haven't we? So half-lives very likely have changed in the past, and that's one thing the scientists are really studying very closely right now. So if we look at this table, we see the element of half-lives. And we say, okay, I have a rock, and it has half uranium-238, and half of it has lead-206. That means that it's 4.47 billion-year-old rock. Does that make sense? We have thunder. Oh, okay. Is this speaker? Oh, okay. All right. So we have that half-life, right? So now here's some assumptions that are being made. First of all, the assumption is the clock was set to zero when the rock formed. So think of an hourglass. And when that rock is in a molten state, all the sand is on one side of the hourglass. And when that rock cools and it hardens, no more daughter element can escape anymore. So now you flip over the hourglass and you start timing. And you're looking at all the uranium, and you're watching it drop and turning into lead-206. all the time, and it's continually doing that once it's in a cold state. But in a molten state, that there should be no lead 206, it should have melted away. The other assumption is that we're in a closed system, that nothing is able to remove the daughter elements from the rock. Now, this has proven to be false already. One of the things that happens is if we look at a rock, and we can see that different types of rain and everything, we have the acid rain actually can work through rocks. You'll find rain, you'll actually find reservoirs of water inside of mountains. It's working its way through the rocks. And it has been shown that it can carry away some of the daughter element with it. And when it does, what happens? It carries away the daughter element from the upper layer of rock and puts it into a lower layer of rock, and it makes the lower layer of rock look even older than it actually is. The other one is that the decay rate is constant. And remember, we talked about a decay rate is very much based upon the speed of light. And they're looking at the correlation between the speed of light and the decay rate, and if the speed of light has changed, has that affected the decay rate as well? So because of gravitational time dilation, different other theories that are out there, that's something that's being examined. We don't have any firm evidence on it, so we don't really talk about it much here. But the decay rate has to be constant. So what happened in 1997, there was a group of 8 research scientists. They called themselves the RATE group, and the RATE acronym was for Radioisotopes in the Age of the Earth. And these 8 scientists, we had some PhDs in physics and geology and geophysics and other areas that all got together, and they said, we need to investigate the assumptions that are commonly held in radioisotope dating. So they set out to figure out, well, how do we figure this out? How do we determine whether these assumptions are accurate or not? They said, it's a real easy, simple problem. All you got to do is find out how old the rock is and then date it. But how do we know how old the rock is? Can we walk out into the street and pick up a rock, look at the bottom, and it says born on 1992, right? And we don't have any date on there, but we do. So what they did is they went to Mount St. Helens. Mount St. Helens erupted in 1986, and a lava dome formed on Mount St. Helens. That rock was molten, and it cooled. And according to the radioisotope dating method, that when it was in its molten state, any of the daughter elements should have escaped from that rock. So we know how old the rock is because we visibly seen it cool. So we went to Mount St. Helens, and they took a bunch of rock samples from the lava dome in Mount St. Helens, and they sent them off to different laboratories. And one of the things that happened when they sent them off to the laboratories came back with the usual standard response is, where'd you find the rocks, and how old do you think they are? They said, because of the experimentation that we're doing with this, we can't give you any of the date, because if they told them they're from the lava dome Mount St. Helens, and they said, well, that's simple, it's 1987, here you go. Or 1986, actually, and here you go, here's the rock back. We don't need it. So they didn't tell them how old the rock was, they didn't tell them where they found the rock, or how old they think the rock was, or where they found it. They didn't tell which strata, which layer they found it in. That's what they were asking. Which layer did you find it in? How old do you think it is? And where did you find it? What part of the earth? Because a lot of the scientific laboratories, instead of trying to run the test again and again and again, they say, okay, you found it in this location. Well, we found other rocks in that location. We dated them to this age, so here it must be that age too. It's an assumption that was being made. So they had different laboratories actually date these rocks. When they dated the Mount St. Helens rocks, they came back with ages anywhere from 500,000 to 2.8 million years old. That's pretty interesting, isn't it? What's really interesting, not only is these rocks considered to be half a million or to 2.8 million years old, is the date range. 500,000 to 2.8 million. That's an extreme date range in there. That's because the rocks, when they do the samples of the rocks, they're looking for parent and daughter elements, whether it be polonium, whether it be something like, polonium usually doesn't work for rocks, but uranium-236, and all the different types of elements that they can use to try and get dates. What they're looking for is where they can find the most of a daughter and parent element together, and that way they can get a good ratio, and they get a better date. So depending upon the lab and what they're looking for and what measurements they're using, they get very wide-ranging dates. Now, they didn't just stop at Mount St. Helens. They also went to New Zealand. There's a New Zealand lava flows, and they took 11 samples from the lava and the New Zealand lava flows. These lava flows were witnessed in 1949, 1954, 1975, so they're a little bit older. Maybe they had a little better time. Maybe they can get a little more accurate date. The dates they got back from those are anywhere from 270,000 to 3.5 million years old. Now, the interesting thing is some of the rock samples that they sent out to the labs came back with dates that are older than the age of the Earth, older than the 4.6 billion years. So what they were able to determine We'll let the evolutionist answer it for himself. Radiometric dating would not have been feasible if the geological column had not been erected first. What they're saying is if we never put dates on the column first, we couldn't use radiometric dating. Because if I say, okay, this is from the Jurassic period, it's probably 100 million years old, the laboratories will say, okay, it must be somewhere in the 100 million. We'll find some data that might match up to that, and that's the data we'll give you. That's how they date rock. And that's why fossils date the rocks more accurately. Because the rock dating method is completely inaccurate. In other words, we assign the ages to the rocks first, and we can't date them, so we just assign a date to it, and then we try to find something that'll match that date. Can't turn into the age of a rock. So basically, I can hold up a rock right now, and I can say this rock is 1,000 years old, and you cannot prove me wrong. And I can hold up that same rock a day later, and I can say this rock is 2 million years old, and you cannot prove me wrong. But the burden of proof isn't on you to prove me wrong. The burden of proof is upon me to prove I'm correct. That's something that we forget a lot of times, not only in just normal society, but particularly in science. The burden of proof is on proving your statement to be true. The burden of proof isn't to try and prove me wrong, because you can't prove me wrong for a date of a rock. There's no boron date on the bottom of the rock to prove me wrong. I can state anything I want. That's basically where it goes. So how do we know that how old the rocks are? By the fossils, right? So let's take a look at the fossils. Here's another quote. Ever since William Smith at the beginning of the 19th century, fossils have been and still are the best and most accurate method of dating and correlating the rocks in which they occur. They're saying the fossils are the most accurate method of dating a rock. But here comes the problem. It says, apart from very modern examples, which are really archaeology, I can think of no cases of radioactive decay being used to date fossils. So how are they dating the fossils to date the rocks? He's saying, it's just archaeology that we use. Anything else with the fossils, we don't use radiometric dating. Now, if fossils date the rocks, how do we date the fossils? What about carbon-14 dating? You heard of carbon-14 dating, right? Carbon-14 dating is what we use to date fossils. Now, carbon-14 is an isotope. It's just like uranium-236 and all these other polonium isotopes and everything. It's a radioactive. It's not a stable, and it has what's called a half-life. Now, all carbon atoms have 6 protons, but they can vary in the number of neutrons. Now, carbon-12 has 6 protons and 6 neutrons, and it's considered a stable. Its nucleus has 6 protons, 6 neutrons. It's a stable element. Carbon-12 is stable. It won't change. Carbon-14 has 6 protons and 7 neutrons. It's not a stable element. Eventually, it'll decay. Carbon-13. Carbon-14 has 6 protons and 8 neutrons. And that, see, 6 and 8 is 14. That's where you get the carbon-14 from. Extra neutrons lead to instability and radioactivity. And that's what happens. Now, scientists use carbon-14, or at least they used to, or they tried to date once-living animals. So where does carbon-14 even come from? Carbon-14 atoms are actually created by cosmic rays that bombard the nitrogen that's in our atmosphere. So these rays hit the nitrogen that's in our atmosphere, and they turn that nitrogen from nitrogen over to carbon-14. So carbon-14 is created, and it's constantly being created in our atmosphere. So the atmosphere has carbon-14 atoms in it, and the atmosphere also has carbon-12 atoms in it. Now, carbon-12s are constant. They don't change. We don't create them. They don't grow. They don't die. It's constant. So if we understand the ratio between carbon-12 and carbon-14 atoms, we can get to a point where we can start dating things. See, carbon is something that we take in as human beings. Anything that's living brings in carbon-12 and carbon-14. Plants absorb carbon from the atmosphere, and we eat the plants. And as long as we're eating the plants, we absorb the carbon-12 and the carbon-14 as well. So if we take a look at the life cycle of carbon-12 and carbon-14, carbon-14 exists and it's solid and it stays and it doesn't really change. So we've got a constant rate of carbon-12 in the atmosphere, but carbon-12 is coming into the atmosphere. So if we eat a plant, the plant absorbs carbon-14, and we eat that plant, and now we absorb that carbon-14 into our bodies, and as long as we keep eating, and as long as we keep breathing the carbon-14 in the air, we keep absorbing, and we maintain the same ratio of carbon-12 to carbon-14 in our bodies as what's in the atmosphere. And that'll continue until we stop breathing and we stop eating. In other words, until we die. Once we die, usually you stop eating and you stop breathing. That usually is what happens for most people, right? So when that happens, we stop bringing in carbon 14 and we stop maintaining that ratio that we had with the atmosphere of carbon 14. So if we know how long carbon 14 lasts before it decays out, we should be able to determine this. Now, here's one thing, is the ratio, since carbon 14 is being created in our atmosphere, we need to make sure that our atmosphere has a constant ratio of carbon 12 to carbon 14. Now, according to all the mathematical calculations, we know the rate of carbon 14 coming into the atmosphere, and we know the half-life of carbon 14, which is 5,730 years of when it turns back into actual carbon 12, turns from carbon 14 back into nitrogen. So it creates this little cycle. Carbon 14 is created from nitrogen being hit by the rays. 5,730 years, half of that turns back into nitrogen again to go back through this life cycle. So if you think of this, the Earth's atmosphere should be in what we call an equilibrium point. Think of it as a water faucet. Say we turn on the water faucet in our house and the sink starts filling up with water. But we drill some holes in the side of the sink. So as there gets to a certain point, water starts coming out of the sink. But there's more water going in than coming out, so the sink water level keeps rising. Eventually, it'll get to the point where there's as much going out of the sink as coming into the sink, and that's what's called the equilibrium point. Carbon-14 is that way with the atmosphere. There's so much carbon-14 being generated in the atmosphere, and there's so much that's being turned, half-life of carbon-14 turned back into nitrogen again. And when the carbon-14 coming into the atmosphere equals the amount of carbon-14 going back out of the atmosphere, we reach the equilibrium point. Now, all the calculations of that say that within 10,000 years, 30,000 at the very latest, the Earth's atmosphere has to be in equilibrium. So that was the basis of the carbon-12 and carbon-14 dating method. Because the Earth's atmosphere would be in equilibrium, we can do this. So if we look at the decay rate, carbon-14 decays at 5,730 years. Remember, if we had a jar of carbon-14, after 5,730 years of holding that jar in front of you, I'll have a sore arm. But besides that, we'll also have half a jar of carbon-14 and half a jar of nitrogen. Carbon-12 is stable, and it stays. It's never going to change. So if we measure the amount of carbon-12 to carbon-14 that's in the atmosphere today, and then we measure the amount of carbon-12 to carbon-14 in a bone of an animal, and we look at the difference in the ratio, that tells us the age of the animal. So if we had half the carbon-14 in that animal bone today than what we do with the atmosphere, then that animal should be around 5,730 years old as the age of when it died. Does that make sense? Now, here's the other thing. After about 150,000 years of watching a decay rate, we don't have equipment that's sensitive enough to measure the difference between the carbon-12 that's in the specimen and the atmosphere. Because the carbon-14, remember, it decays half-life, 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 half-life. After 150,000 years worth of decaying, there's just not enough left that we can actually measure the difference between that and the error of the equipment itself. So there's just very little left. But there are some assumptions. First, the assumption is the carbon-14 to carbon-12 ratio in the atmosphere is constant today. The other assumption is that the Earth is 4.6 billion years old. That ratio has to be in equilibrium, right? Because it only takes 10,000, 30,000 years maximum to reach equilibrium. So we absolutely have to have that atmosphere in equilibrium today. Now, Dr. Willard Libby was the founder of carbon-14 dating. And he noted that atmosphere did not happen to be in equilibrium. Now, that was a troubling idea for Dr. Willard Libby, because see, Dr. Willard Libby was an evolutionist, and he believed that the Earth was billions of years old, and there enough time had passed, most definitely, to reach equilibrium. But he chose to ignore the discrepancy, and he attributed it to experimental error. Basically, he said, okay, the measurements had to be off, or something had to be off. It has to be in equilibrium. It's not a problem. However, that discrepancy turned out to be very real. And if we measure the amount of carbon-14 to carbon-12 that's in the air today, we know it is not constant. In fact, more carbon-14 is being produced at 18.8 atoms per gram per minute, and the decay is still only at 16.1 atoms per gram. Or disintegrations per gram per minute. So basically, more carbon-14 is coming into the atmosphere still than is being removed from the atmosphere. We haven't reached equilibrium yet. That means the Earth's atmosphere is not in equilibrium, and if it's not in equilibrium, even if we can measure the amount of carbon-14 that's in a fossil today, if we don't know how much was in there when it died, we don't know how old it is. That's the big problem. So we may know what's in there today, we may know what the ratio is today, but we don't know how old it is. Now, archaeologists because of other dating methods, you know, finding it in the bones and wood and stuff like that in a city that we know the age the city was around from this many years to this many years, have been able to look at the carbon-14 that's in something and say, okay, we know how much carbon-14 is left in this, so we should see those similar results in something that same age. So they're kind of reversing the carbon-14 dating method. And that only works for about 3,000 years because we don't have any good solid evidence of other means of dating something other than carbon-14 past that, because we don't have historical records going back any further than that of knowing this settlement was here at this time period. So now we can measure the carbon-14. But there's a couple other problems. We found that carbon-14 isn't absorbed by all plants equally. Some plants absorb carbon-14 more than others. And if an animal depends upon one plant that absorbs more carbon-14 than another, it's going to look younger. And if one animal focuses and eats primarily plants that don't absorb much carbon-14, it'll appear to be much older. So there's some examples of this here. Problem is the Fairbanks Creek Mammoth. The lower leg of the Fairbanks Creek Mammoth was dated to be 15,380 years old, but the skin itself was dated to be 21,300 years old. So in other words, this animal lived for 6,000 years without a leg, and then it grew one. Now we have the Volosovich Mammoth was radiocarbon dated to be 29,500 years old, but another part of it was 44,000 years old, but that isn't where it ends. Living mollusk shells are being carbon dated at being 2,300 years old. Freshly killed seal was carbon dated at being 1,300 years old. Carbon-14 is a serious problem for dating because we don't know the ratios. The carbon-14 ratio levels in the atmosphere vary depending upon where you're at in the atmosphere, but the key point is that we haven't reached equilibrium. Since we're not in equilibrium of carbon-14 in the atmosphere, all the dating methods are off because we don't know how much carbon-14 was in it when it died. So what do the scientists have to say about that? If carbon-14 date supports our theories, we'll put it in the main text. If it doesn't entirely contradict them, we'll put it as a footnote. And if it's completely out of date, we just drop it. In other words, carbon-14, they'll use it as evidence to support their idea and their belief about the age of something if they can get a carbon-14 date that'll match it. If it's kind of close, they'll put it as a footnote, saying, yeah, it kind of supports us. And if it doesn't, they don't even worry about it because they know it's not accurate. Remember when we talked a little bit about it yesterday, we talked about scientists and ignoring data that doesn't agree with them? Some of the data that they're ignoring, they ignore because they already know it's bad data to begin with. But they'll use it if it agrees with them. That's a bad thing. So let's take a look at some of the facts of carbon-14 dating. Carbon-14 dating has been around as long as the Earth has had an atmosphere. As long as the Earth has had an atmosphere, there's been cosmic rays hitting nitrogen and turning nitrogen into carbon-14. Now, carbon-14 to carbon-12 ratio on the Earth is not in equilibrium. That means carbon-14 dating is not reliable. But it also means something else. The Earth's atmosphere should have been in equilibrium within 10,000 years, 30,000 at the very outside. The Earth has not had enough carbon-14 buildup in the atmosphere for even 10,000 years. So what does that mean? After 150,000 years, there should remain no carbon-14 enough to measure in a specimen. Specimens that are assumed to be millions of years old, dinosaur fossils, dinosaur legs, and stuff like that, still have measurable amounts of carbon-14 in them. And they're supposed to be well over 150,000 years old. Now, based upon that information, though, the Earth has to be less than 10,000 years old, 30,000 at the very max, because we're not in equilibrium. So we have an atmosphere that's not in equilibrium, and that tells us something completely different than what carbon-14 was supposed to tell us. It tells us that this atmosphere hasn't had a time to reach equilibrium yet. The atmosphere can't be, at the very outside, can't be more than 30,000 years old. Now, most calculations put it at about 10,000 years, and since we're not quite at equilibrium yet, we're about 67%, 70% of the way to equilibrium, we're probably around 6,000, 7,000 years old. That matches up with one date pretty well, doesn't it? But remember the limiting factor? Remember in the coin and the ship. The coin and the ship tells us when it had to have sunk. It can't have sunk any sooner than that date. The Earth's atmosphere can't be any older than 30,000 years. Not possible from a scientific standpoint. So, let's continue on a little bit. Now that we talked about carbon-14, we talked a little bit about radiometric dating of rocks, we take a look at the only evidence that the evolution theory has for an old age of an Earth, which is basically the rocks and the fossils. And we determined that we can't date a fossil and we can't date a rock. The only way we can look at it, we can say, well, it could be this old, but it may not be, and nobody can prove that right or wrong. But there's other things that we can look at on the earth. We can look at the Sahara Desert. The Sahara Desert is evidence, actually, of the age of the earth, or at least it's evidence of the age of the earth when it's outside of water. Because the Sahara Desert has what's called a prevailing wind pattern. And all the deserts are like that. They have what's called a prevailing wind pattern. And this causes a desert to grow over time. It's called desertification. So what happens is we have a prevailing wind pattern. We have the wind pattern going from Egypt, and it's going across Africa, and it's creating the Sahara Desert. Well, as it's going across the desert, the air cannot pick up any moisture because there is none to pick up. So it doesn't rain. And as it continues and we get this prevailing wind pattern going after year after year after year after year after year, the desert actually grows because there's less and less moisture and the desert continues to grow. Now, when we look online, we can look at how do you date a desert? How do you determine how old the desert is? And they talk about the Gobi Desert and they talk about some different deserts. The Namib Desert, they consider that to be one of the oldest deserts in the world. But here's how they dated the Nabi Desert. But basically what they did is they said they found some rocks. And they said these rocks were about 1 million years old, but rocks don't need a desert, do they? A rock is a rock, whether it's underwater or it's in the desert. But they also call what they also date it by looking at the sand dunes. They say the Namib Desert has these big giant sand dunes, and it had to take a long time for these sand dunes to build up. And they look at the process of the growth of a sand dune. They say, okay, if the sand dune grows at this rate, it would take this many years to go from the flat ground all the way up to this big of a sand dune. Well, the problem with sand dunes is they move. They grow, but they also drop. And they go higher, and they go down. And sometimes they grow up very quickly, sometimes they drop very quickly. There's no actual measurable data that tells us how much a sand dune either grows or shrinks in a year. We can't average that out because it changes so much. An entire city in a desert can be just covered in sand in a matter of years, and you don't even find it anymore. Or one can be just blown completely free, and you'll see an old city that comes back up from the desert. So we can't use sand dunes to measure it. The only thing we can do that's reliable is desertification. That's the process of the growth of the desert. Now, deserts grow year by year by year. As long as there's no outside influence, as long as there's no agriculture, irrigation, or anything like that going on within the desert continues to grow. So if we look at the age of the Sahara Desert, the Sahara Desert grows by a certain amount every year. And they're looking at the growth of the desert, and they're saying if it's growing average at this amount per year, then the desert must be approximately 4,000 years old. Now, there's something very interesting about that date, 4,000 years. If we go back into our Bible and we look at our Bible, what happened about 4,000 years ago? There was a flood. Now, you can't have a desert if there's a worldwide flood. But you can start a desert after a flood ends. But that's about as far back as you can go. So the process of desertification, by looking at the average growth of a desert, the Sahara Desert is considered to be the oldest desert on the earth from that process, and it's 4,000 years old. Now, that's not the only thing. If we take a look at the deserts, that tells us one thing about the age of the earth, but we can also take a look at oil wells. Oil wells generate a lot of pressure. That oil that's in that well is building up, and it builds up pressure. There's gases that are built up in an oil well, and they continue to build up pressure, more and more pressure, and they can have pressures up to 20,000 pounds. 20,000 PSI, 20,000 pounds per square inch. Now, a lot of the work that I used to do in the past, I worked with a lot of people in the oil industry, geologists, roughnecks, and different things like that. When I did hydraulic instructing, I worked with a lot of different oil companies. I did a lot of instructing on how to handle the hydraulics that are used on oil wells, and I get a chance to talk with a lot of different people. Some of the oil well geologists that I wound up talking to over the years all told me one thing: oil wells build pressure. So when you tap into a new oil well, there's a lot of pressure in there, extreme amount of pressures. You ever seen the movies and the TV shows and the oil wells just shooting straight into the air, oil spraying way up high, and if it catches fire, you got this big fire, and you got the firefighters that are coming out and trying to, you know, knock out the fire, and they have to use an explosion. They have to kill all the oxygen around it to actually kill the fire. There's a lot of pressure under an oil well. And as they tap that oil well, that pressures decrease over time. And over here in the United States, a lot of those oil pressures aren't as high as they are like over in the Middle East and stuff like that, but they are very, very high, like down in Texas. But over time, as you pull more and more oil out, you relieve the pressure. And when they pull more and more oil out, they relieve that pressure down, and it gets to the point now they have to pump in water to push the oil back out. Because oil's lighter than water. Oil floats on top of water, so they pump in the water goes down to the bottom and pushes the oil out. Then they cap that oil well when the price of the oil drops. They say, well, okay, you know what? We'll just cap this oil well. We won't produce any more oil out of here because it's not as profitable to pull oil out of this well right now because we're pumping water in. They cap it, and they let it sit for years. And every once in a while, if they don't open that well back up again, they have to uncap it and pull some oil out of it because the pressure's building up. Oil continually builds pressure over time. Now, oil wells can have up to 20,000 PSI. Now, that's a lot stronger worth of pressure than the overburdened rock that's upon that oil well. All that rock, all the earth that oil well's sitting underneath can't hold that much pressure all that long. We actually see evidence of that. If you go out to California, you go to La Brea tar pits. The rock wasn't able to hold back the pressure, and that's where the tar pits came from. The oil comes up to the surface. So we know that the rock is only capable of holding back so much pressure for so long of a period of time, and the rock can only hold that pressure for approximately 10,000 years. 20,000 PSI can only hold that pressure for approximately 10,000 years or less, all the calculations that are done on it. These are structural calculations and everything else. So we have a limit as far as these oil wells. If we had a millions of year old earth or billions of year old earth, every single oil well should be on the surface by now. We should have never been able to hold pressure in oil wells for more than this period of time that we have today. But that's not the only thing. We also have ice core samples. Now, evolutionists like to use ice core samples as evidence of an old age of an earth. Here's the layers that represent annual rings. They say when the snow melts in the summer, it refreezes and we have clear ice and it shows up as a dark ring. You know, we got the ice strip. And then in the wintertime, the snow just packs up on top of it and that's the white strip. And then the summertime comes around again and that top layer of snow kind of melts back down again. We get that warm layer again and it creates another dark strip. So if we look dark, light, dark, strike, dark, light, that's annual rings. We got summer, winter, summer, winter, summer, winter, summer, winter, summer, winter as we go down through the rings. So if we take a look at it, in Greenland and Antarctic, where the weather is consistently dry and very cold, the glaciers are miles thick and the annual rings are very thin. The deepest cores can measure 10,000 feet. Cores from Greenland drilled since 1990 show the northern climate was erratic 135,000 years ago. So if we look at summer, winter, summer, winter, summer, winter, summer, winter, that's what we see. We see 135,000 years worth of ice accumulation at the poles. Now, why wouldn't it be all the way up to the top of the atmosphere? Ice packs down, the weight of the ice, it'll squeeze those layers and they get thinner and thinner and thinner and thinner. That's one of the things. But have you ever heard of the Lost Squadron of World War II? The Lost Squadron of World War II was a group of airplanes, and these group of airplanes were being ferried from the United States over to England for the World War II, for the effort in World War II. Now, as these airplanes left the United States, they flew up to Greenland, and they flew and they landed, refueled in Greenland, then they went to another base in Greenland, they refueled, and they were heading over to Iceland. And on the way over to Iceland, one of the planes developed mechanical issues. They were close enough to return back to Greenland, but not to get to Iceland. So what they decided, the squadron decided to turn around as a group, and they landed back on the east side of Greenland. They made it back to the coast of Greenland, they landed on a bunch of the ice and snow that was up there in Greenland, and they stopped the planes, they were rescued, the pilots were taken, and they looked at the planes and they said, okay, you know what, we can come back for the planes a little later on because they'd have to get fuel to the planes again to keep them flying and everything else, and they forgot about them. And after a time period of forgetting about them, the war continues on and it comes to an end, and the planes aren't there anymore. So the planes landed in 1942 in Greenland, and a group decided to find this lost squadron. They knew that it was there, they knew the approximate location of where it was, but you wouldn't be able to see the planes anymore because they were buried under snow. You had a lot of snow that was developed going year and year and year, and these planes kept getting buried under more and more snow, and eventually they couldn't find the planes anymore. So what they did is they took ground-penetrating radar, and they went back and forth and back and forth until they finally found the planes. They found them. They were able to locate them. And here's a picture of them going down to find those planes. These ice rings, or these planes were buried under hundreds of ice rings. See, an ice ring isn't summer, winter, summer, winter. An ice ring is above freezing, below freezing, above freezing, below freezing. How many times can the weather go above freezing to below freezing in a year? It can go 100 times easy. If you go up north, and if you live up north like in Minnesota, or you go up into Canada and you live up there for a while, you can actually leave a car parked out in the driveway and leave it parked out there for a few weeks. And you'll get a few snowy days in there, and you'll take a look at the snow that's sitting on your windshield, and if you cut into the snow and pull it away, you'll see rings. warm, cold, warm, cold, warm, cold, just in a matter of a few days. So you'll see those layers that develop. These planes were buried very deep in the snow and under hundreds of ice rings. Now, the Lost Quadrant was covered by 263 feet of ice over a 48-year period. They sat there for 48 years, and in 48 years they were covered under 263 feet of ice. Now, 1942 to 1990, which is when they were found, was 48 years. The planes were buried under 263 feet below the surface. That's about 5.5 feet worth of snow accumulation each year. Not very much for Greenland. 5.5 feet isn't all that much. You go up into the Rockies, you know, you can get 15 feet in a good snowfall. So, 5.5 feet on average per year. Now, if we took that 10,000-foot core sample from Greenland and we divide it by 5.5 feet, that's about 1,824 years worth of snow accumulation, not 135,000 years. So if we use that example, we find a completely different date. Now, deeper ice is pressed into finer and finer layers, so 4,000 years for ice to accumulate at the poles is not a problem for all the ice that we have today. There's no problem for all that ice if we take a core sample all the way down to dirt. No problem for that ice to accumulate over 4,000 years. Now, the planes don't sink due to the pressure on the ice. In fact, planes are always nose heavy, and there's a reason for that. If a plane is a little bit nose heavy, we'd want the nose to go down first. And if they were sinking, the noses would have dropped in, and they would have went down nose first, but they were falling flat. So they weren't actually sinking in the ice. The reason why a plane is nose heavy is more stable. If you get into a slow flight condition with a plane, you can get into what's called a stall. And if you get into a stall, that means you lose enough lift on the wings where the plane starts to drop. And you want a nose-heavy plane because when you have a nose-heavy plane, it drops the front of the nose first so that you can pick up airspeed and regain lift and recover from your stall. If you didn't have a nose-heavy plane, it'd stall tail first and you'd never recover and you'd crash. Actually, when you look at a plane, you have the wings that are on the front of the plane and the wings provide lift. The elevator that's on the back of the plane, that provides downward lift. It actually pushes the tail down to hold the nose up. Now, planes are actually designed to be nose heavy. They're more stable. If you don't design it with a forward center of gravity, if you have a rearward center of gravity, if you get into a stall, that's it. You're done. There's no recovery. So they don't sink. They didn't sink into the ground. They laid horizontally. Otherwise, they would have sank nose first. Now, that's a little bit about ice layers. But what about the Grand Canyon? Evolution say the Colorado River carved the Grand Canyon over millions and millions of years, didn't they? They carved the Colorado River carved that Grand Canyon over millions of years. But let's take a little bit of look at the evidence. See, the Colorado River enters the Grand Canyon at 2,800 foot worth of elevation, and rivers usually run downhill. Not many of them run uphill very often. Now, the Grand Canyon slopes up to the top of the Grand Canyon anywhere from 6,900 to 8,500 foot of elevation. So that 2,800 foot elevation river had to have flown uphill to carve out the Grand Canyon. That's normally a little bit of a problem. The ground slopes up. So do rivers actually run uphill? Not normally, they don't. So how can you explain this? 270 miles with a canyon being carved going uphill. Well, if we take a look at it, the snow line actually tells us a story. The Grand Canyon is more likely a breach in a giant dam. They call it the Kaibab uplift. And basically, we had an uplift, a rising up of the ground, not only right at the Grand Canyon, but around that area, that pushed up to an elevation around 8,000 feet, anywhere from 7,000 to 8,500 feet. Now, if we take a look, and if we put a dam today where the Grand Canyon exists, and we put a dam across there, we'd develop a lake. The Colorado River would form into a large lake. And that large lake, we actually see evidence of that today. If we look around the area around the Grand Canyon, and you look at the elevation of the Grand Canyon, and you go back upstream of the Colorado River, and you stay at that elevation, you see two lakes that have formed. You see the evidence of the ancient shorelines of these lakes. They're Grand Lake and Hopi Lake, is what they're called. Now, if we had a global flood, we would have had these big giant lakes that cover almost three states. If we take a look at this, the remnants of the shoreline are actually at those elevations are all the way around the Grand Canyon. So we know that the water at one point was all the way to the top of the Grand Canyon before the Grand Canyon forms. Rivers don't flow uphill, but a lake does. And if we ever get a breach in a dam and it goes up over the top, what happens? We ever see, like, when we dam up for the rivers and stuff around here, if you ever get a breach, what happens is it starts small and it just explodes, doesn't it? All of a sudden it starts ripping everything through with it. That's a fast-moving fast-moving dam breach gives what we call two things. We wind up with barbed canyons, and we wind up with V-shaped canyons. So barbed canyons are formed as a result of a washout from a spillway. So if we got a big reservoir and we get a washout, what happens is as the water gets washed out, it carves a channel in the dam breach, and it goes down and down, and what happens, all the water goes back into the lake and then comes forward again to go out through that channel. So you get what's called barbed canyons, and the Grand Canyon is full of barbed canyons. All the canyons in the Grand Canyons are always back-driving canyons to the Colorado River. That happens from washed-out spillways. It doesn't happen from just meandering rivers that go through the canyon. Now, if water's draining from a spillway, we usually have a greater than 90-degree angle for the canyon, the barbed canyon. That's where we get all these barbed canyons. But we also see V-shaped canyons. And fast-moving rivers create V-shaped canyons. Now, geologically speaking, the Colorado River is a slow-moving river in the Grand Canyon. It doesn't move anywhere near fast enough to create a V-shaped canyon. When water flows through fast, it carves everything out. It carves out a channel and creates a big V-shape. When water is moving slowly and it's continually and consistently carving through earth, it creates a U-shape. And if you look at the Grand Canyon, it's all V-shaped canyon till the present-day Colorado River, and then where the Colorado River is taking its turns, there's U-shape undercutting there. But only there, not anything above it. So what we see with the Colorado River is really a fast-forming canyon. So the Grand Canyon could have actually been formed from the Grand Lake breach of the dam in just a matter of days. And we actually see some of that today. If we take a look, Mount St. Helens, when Mount St. Helens erupted, there was a lake down by the base of Mount St. Helens. And when Mount St. Helens erupted, it pushed a lot of dirt and debris into that lake. And what it did is it shoved all the water out of the lake back into the rivers. And what that did is created a fast-moving river coming out of Mount St. Helens area, and it created a canyon. 600-foot deep river canyon formed at Mount St. Helens in just a matter of days. It doesn't take thousands and millions of years to form the Grand Canyon. 600 feet formed in just a matter of a day. It doesn't take all that long. But the other thing that's really interesting, it produces fine strata layers almost instantaneously. As it's flowing everything down the river, it's leaving behind material. But the interesting thing is material, when it's flowing through water, heavier material settles down to the bottom, lighter material as it goes up, and it creates a strata, it creates layers. Just like we see in the Grand Canyon, and just like we see now over by Mount St. Helens, we see these geological layers being created. And they're not anywhere similar to the geological column. They're just layers. That's where we get the geological column that has missing layers, upside down layers, and everything else like that. It's most likely created by water. So large geological figures can form very rapidly. Here's the little Grand Canyon of the Tuttle River up by Mount St. Helens. That formed in just one day. Now, what's interesting about that is when we talk about water, and we talk about canyons, we talk about flooding, and we talk about a worldwide flood, did you know that every culture in the world has a remembrance of a worldwide flood? Every culture in the world has a story of a worldwide flood. One of the other things is the human population. Last weekend, the world's population was top 6 billion. That's according to a 1999 Star Tribune out of Minneapolis, Minnesota article. Today, that population is around 7 billion. So there's about 7 billion of us that live in the world today. That's a lot of people. But we do have a lot of space, too. We still have some open areas. We still have some land you can grab if you want some. Now, the question has to come in, if we have an Earth that's 4.6 billion years old, and if we've had people on this earth for about 4 million years, what happened to everybody? Where is everyone? If we assume that the average lifespan on earth is about 50 years, and we assume a staple population of only 100,000 people, so at any time throughout the entire history of the earth, no more than 100,000 people were alive at any given time. Not the 7 billion we have today, but just 100,000 people. And if we had just 4 million years worth of human life at just 100,000 people, 50 years a person, we would have 800 billion bodies on this earth by now. That's a lot of missing bodies that just can't be accounted for. So let's take a close look at that date. So So here we go. The world's population is historically doubled about every 150 years. That's independence of wars, it's independence of famines and disease and everything else. It's the average population. Now we know we have population census. We go back into biblical times, we look at the Romans. The Romans were taking population census. David was taking a population, you know, Solomon, everybody else. So we have the Chinese, they were taking census of their population throughout all their history as well. So we have some good historical evidence as to what the population growth is. And about 150 years worth the population on the earth is historically doubled, independent of famines, wars, and diseases. Now if we start with six people, and we take six and we double that every 150 years, we double it 30 times to reach 7 billion people. So all you have to do is double the number six, 30 times, and you get 7 billion people. You ever heard of the story of the man who asked the king to pay him with a doubling of a penny on a checkerboard? And he was a rich man by the time he reached the end of the checkerboard, don't you? Start with one penny, then you got two, then you got four, then you got eight. By the time you get through that checkerboard, you got a lot of money. So it only takes 30 times that we need to double the population from 6 people to 7 billion people to get 7 billion. 30 times. And if we have 150 years, the population doubles, that means in 4,500 years, we could start with 6 people and we could reach 7 billion people that we have today without a problem. What happened about 4,000 years ago? Was there a flood? And if there was a flood and we had 8 people on the flood, now we can take Noah and his wife, and they probably didn't have more children because we don't have any record of it, but they had sons, and their sons had wives, and they had children. And if we started from those 6, those 3 sons and those 3 daughters, daughter-in-laws, we have 6 people that starts a population around 4,000 years ago and reaches 7 billion people by today. Now, we had a lot of dating methods that we've covered tonight. We talked about 10 different dating methods that prove a young age of the Earth, whether it be the carbon-14 in the atmosphere, whether it be the population, but we have a lot more that are here. As you go through and you look at all these are all methods that prove a young age of an Earth. These are all dating methods of the Earth that show that this Earth cannot be more than 10,000 years old. If we were to take a look at that ship and remember that ship, that coin says 1750, the ship didn't sink before 1750. If the dating methods say that this Earth cannot have existed for more than 10,000 years, then this Earth cannot have existed for more than 10,000 years. We know for a fact that atmosphere could not have existed on this Earth for more than 10,000 years. So how do we get with a 4.6 billion year old Earth? When we talked about last night, we want to share with you all the evidence. This is factual evidence. This is evidence that is not in dispute. It can't be disputed. It's truthful. It's factual. We got the simple answer. It's empirical. It's observable. And it's recordable and measurable. It meets the scientific method criteria. You know, astronomy states that there's around 2 to 3% of the space in our solar system that's conducive to life. And we look on our Earth and we have all the elements that are necessary for life. We have oxygen, we have water, we have warmth, and we have cooling. We're not too hot, we're not too cold. The list can go on and on and on, and everything that's necessary for us for life on this Earth. And then we live in a spot in the solar system that's only 2 to 3% in our entire solar system that can support life. And our planet happens to be in that exact orbit. If we were 1% further away from the sun, we'd have freezing temperatures. Average temperatures would be freezing. We'd have a frozen planet. If we were 2% closer, the water would evaporate. It would boil off our planet. We live in that perfect spot in its Earth. And we talked about it a little bit last night. We have walked through a room in a person's house, and you see a little baby room in there. You see the crib. You see the rocking chair. You know they're expecting a baby. We look at our Earth, and we look at the position of our Earth in our solar system. We look at the position of our Earth as far as what it carries necessary for life. We look at the position of the moon. We look at the position of the galaxy, or where we are in the galaxy. Everything is conducive to life. It was like the Earth was designed specifically for life. That's what Isaiah 45:18 says. God himself had formed the Earth, and he made it. He hath established it, and he created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. You know, it's a lot easier to believe the Bible as a source of knowledge and then let science find its answers from the Bible than to try to prove the Bible true through science. And that's what we're doing here tonight. We're trying to show that the Bible had the answers long before science even came up with the experiment. It's all right there for us. It's all right there and easy for us to understand. Now, tomorrow night, we're going to talk about our final episode. And remember I told you guys yesterday that if you're going to miss a night, you should have missed last night? Well, I'm going to tell you that again. If you're going to miss a night, you should have missed tonight, because tomorrow night's going to be even better. We're going to talk about creation or evolution itself. We're going to talk about the origin of life. We're going to talk about chemical evolution. We're going to talk about the origin of life itself on this planet, where we come into the missing links, the fossil record, and everything else. So it'll be it's going to be a really good episode. You're going to definitely want to be here for this. If you're going to miss a night, you should have missed tonight, because tomorrow night you definitely want to be here. So like I mentioned before, if you do have any questions, you do have any thoughts, please write them down on the question cards. You can always come up and talk to me about it. It doesn't matter what the question is. I'll do my best to answer it. Like I said, I've had all kinds of weird questions. Why are pancakes flat? So you won't surprise me or try to stump me by a question, because I always have a default answer. I know somebody else who can answer that for me. So I may not have all the answers, but the answers we do have are factual answers. So I want to thank you guys for coming, and I'll look forward to seeing you tomorrow night, 7 p.m. Thank you.